Welcome to our weekly NIM podcast. This time we would like to show you how to debug NIM programs with GDB and the plugins Arne created for it. And I'll now let Arne speak for himself,
Yes.
and he will show
Okay.
us this, how to debug a simple NIM program that you can see already here on the
Okay.
screen.
Hello. I'm Arne, and I wrote the GDB script or the GDB plugin for better debugging NIM. And for using this plugin, we will make a short tutorial on how to use GDB with NIM. So this is a small example program that I've written to show some features of GDB. So first of all, I want to say I tried to have some debugging experience that is integrated in an IDE. I tried several visual front ends for GDB, but nothing was really satisfying, so we will stick today with command line GDB debugging and Emacs, which is basically the same as the command line GDB, but with the output seen in different Emacs buffers. So this is the program. It's a small debug session. This program doesn't have a bug. I will just show you some printers. It has an enum value. It defines an object, a function. It has a main function to start. And so first of all, let's compile it. The compiler command is important that you pass it debugger native, so that the correct debug information is generated. Otherwise, the C compiler, the backend C compiler, will not put debug symbols in the program. I will compile it. Or basically, yeah, to compile it, I don't need the dash R argument. So, as you see, the program doesn't crash, it works. And when you want to start it with GDB on the command line, you just run GDB, and then what was the name? Debug session, and you can run it. But this way you will not have any specific NIM syntax highlighting. So what I wrote is a little script called NIM GDB. And NIMGDB loads the Python script into your program at startup. Basically, that's everything it does. It just loads the Python script for the pretty printers to print NIM types from GDB. And it forwards all arguments you pass it to GDB. So I can run NIMGDB with debug session. And I've written it here just with the debug session. A weird thing, this is just common GDB interface. When you want to debug a program with additional arguments, like arg1, arg2, this is not how it works. You would assume this is how it works, but you have to pass the command line parameter dash dash args to it, and that before your program. I think that's a weird pattern, but just to be sure, always start your program with dash dash args, and then there's no confusion about it. So the program is started, and you should take care of two lines. Reading symbols from debug session done. And loading NIM runtime support. This is printed when the debugger is loaded. And here it injects the pretty printers in your binary executable. When you see here your executable name, you know everything should work fine. When you do not have symbols from debug session, and you see reading symbols from debug sessions, you think, ah, it's fine, everything works. No, it says reading symbols from debug session, and then it doesn't find it. I'll show. For example, often you do not pass the debugger native parameter. You forget it for some reason, it's not there. So I will compile it again. Now I start the program with GDB. The arguments are arg1 and arg2 are ignored. And now reading symbols from debug symbols, no debug symbols found, done. So it's not an error message. It just tells you there are no debug symbols, and then it goes on. So it's easily forgotten, and then you wonder why it doesn't work. So take care that symbols are available. So I'll recompile it with debug symbols, start it again, and so let's set a breakpoint. I want to break in the function foobar. There are two ways you can break in, or there are more than two ways you can break in foobar. You can do it either with break, and then you say debug session.nim, and then the line, which would be, let's say, 19. Is set breakpoint 1. Info breakpoints, and then lists all the breakpoints. That's one way. Second way is you can say break foobar, and you're debugging a C program here, no NIM program directly. So you need to pass the function how it is called in C. In the info about the breakpoints, you see that we are actually breaking in foobar underscore sf4, and you don't need to remember the full name. You can just say break foobar underscore tab completion, and it does it for you. So breakpoint 2 is basically the same as breakpoint 1. And a third way to do it is r break foobar, and then it breaks in every function that contains foobar. So we have a third breakpoint also at the same line. Info breakpoints, so they're all the same. So since we only need one of them, we can just delete 2 and 3. Then I run the program, and now I'm at breakpoint 1, and you can see it already says the arguments. We have arg1, which is value C, arg2, which is a string, and it says something. When we go in the program, we see we have value C and a string containing something. So this already works. Then when we want to finish a function, we just say finish, and now
that's interesting. I didn't know this command.
We returned. I will show you now the terminal user interface. For now, we only had direct command line, and everything you wanted to know, you actually have to ask GDB directly. But there is a built-in terminal user interface that's a bit more informative. So there's TUI for terminal user interface, and you can enable it, and it says you are here. It just finished the function foobar. So when I press N for next, I can step through the program. N is enough, but you can just write full next. And now the output is messed up because it echoed something. So I press Control L to reset the output. So, okay. Now the function buts is executed with my object, so I can say I want to step into it. So I think it's S. I'm now in function buts, which does nothing, it just discards. You can scroll with arrow up and arrow down. You also see the breakpoint over there. And print arc. It can print you an object. So my object has a member A and B, which are both integers, and an object C, which is a set of enums, and it prints it as a set of enums. So finish. Now we have sets. Let's step over the initialization. And now I can say print sequence 1, and it prints the content. So the sequence 4,4 is the size and the capacity of the sequence. And then there are the elements. And with info locals, you can print all local variables.
Yes, and this is the frame local that NIM produces to produce its own stack frames, which is usually not required when you use GDB. But maybe type BT, please. But the GDB stack trace doesn't look as well as NIM's native backtrace. Sometimes. This time it's pretty nice to look at.
Yeah. Okay. It's just in NIM main module. Yeah. Okay. Here you can see that there are some specific NIM functions called before the actual main is executed. So I think that's it for the simple debugging, for the simple printing of types. So I type quit. So in the end, we want to show you how to find a bug in, for example, the NIM compiler. We know that this is a bug. There's already a pull request for it. But right now, this bug still exists, and we want to show you how you can use the debugger to find this bug. So when I compile again the debug session, the compiler just crashes with a seg fault. So I can compile the compiler in temporary with the debug information. So I have a version of the NIM compiler that's called NIMTemp that has debug information, NIMTemp. And when I use this to compile my program, I get a NIM stack trace. But we want to start it with GDB. We don't want the NIM stack trace, we want GDB for debugging. So we run NIM GDB --args, we are running the compiler in GDB. So I have to type run to start the program, but before I do that, I have to set some breakpoints. The compiler, when it realizes there's a crash somewhere, it does its own handling of that signal to print the stack trace. Normally, when you are debugging a C program or C++ program, when a crash happens, you automatically get in the debugger and you can inspect variables and try to find out why this crash happened. But NIM has its own way of handling the crash, and then it exits, and we don't want that. So we need to break before NIM exits. And NIM exits the program with the quit function, which eventually calls. There's some quit functions. There are several ways how you can break there. There's R break, quit, and then every quit function from NIM will get a breakpoint. And another way is to break on the exit function with this built-in C, and the exit function will eventually be called from every quit proc. So I run now the program, breakpoint 3, quit or debug. I can do backtrace, okay. I enable the terminal interface.
Run it in, no, yeah. Maybe show it in Emacs already.
Yeah, yeah, you're right. I should show this in Emacs. So this is how it works on the command line. I quit. So in Emacs, I can run GDB, and it asks me how I should run GDB with the command line interface. And here's nim GDB. The command, the parameter dash I equals ME is required for Emacs. It means machine interface, so that Emacs can interact with GDB. And then arguments nim temp c debug session. Except from the dash I equals MI, everything is the same. I configured my Emacs so that by default it opens many windows. This checkbox you have to look for in the config is GDBE many windows. So this here on the top left corner is the same interface you would see on the terminal, just in an Emacs buffer. Here is a source file. Here you always have a list of breakpoints. You have the input and output of the program, basically just the output. Here are locals listed and registers, and the arguments of a currently executed function. I often look for it. It's not shown by default. It's the other tab here. I don't know why it's in another tab and not just part of locals, but okay, it works. And here you always have a stack frame. So we break on the exit function. We run. We run the program, and here's the backtrace. From Emacs, the stack trace is interactive, so I can click. So these are all just raising. We want to go last sun. Here, last sun doesn't work. We have T doesn't have a last sun. So what's the value of T? Why doesn't it work? T is a type, and to print, we can just print T, and it tells me it's a pointer type. So we want to print the content of this pointer, and I should remember you, it still thinks it's debugging C, but it's not C. So when we want to dereference a pointer, we should use C's syntax. That's the start, print start. So it tells me it's tie anything.
Sorry, one question. Do you have any idea how to patch GDB so that it understands NIM expression syntax in this print statement?
It is possible to patch it. It is possible to implement a custom syntax, but no, I don't know how to do it. The documentation about GDB is generally very sparse. It is documented. Okay. This.
So what's your guess, like, would it be just another Python script, or would it me imply to patch the GDB's source code?
I honestly don't know. Maybe it is just another Python script, but I don't know.
Okay.
But except from this reference and unreference and so on, the C syntax isn't that bad. Most of the time you just want to look up values from elements, and maybe I should show you when I print T.
Now use the dot, please.
Yeah, I want to show this. I can print T kind. I can also use another way to do it in C is dereference T. This is how you would do it in T dot kind. It should work, but GDB doesn't care if you use a dot or an arrow. You can also use T dot kind directly, or you can do a dereference T and then use the arrow kind, which doesn't make any sense, but it GDB just doesn't care if you use a dot or an arrow.
Okay, and the dot syntax is what Nim also uses, so that that's okay.
So yeah, you cannot use dot calls syntax for function calls, but and you need to, when you actually need to dereference something, it's just for printing. So it's not that bad. And you can actually call functions with the GDB command call, and then you have an expression in C with the C names of the functions. And I made, there's a debug function in Nim to debug type. In Nim it's just called debug. In C it's called debug type because you can set the names for functions explicitly. So functions that you want to call from GDB, it's good if you give them explicit names for C, for with export C. I can show you later how to do this. So call debug type T, and the second argument is a null pointer. Cannot use nil, I need to use actual zero, literal, and it prints what the debug, yeah, there's the output of that function call.
Okay.
So we have a type and anything, and it wants to get the element type, and surely that doesn't work. So I get up in the call stack, change type. It wants to do some change type. So where does it want to do? It checks if it's not the same type, result to, dot type and type. Fit, remove hidden conversion. Basically, this is where the problem is in this if expression. If type not equals nil, there, it's doing it wrong.
Well, it's debatable. What we could do here is to patch the if statement, or you could patch the fit, remove hidden conversion proc instead.
Yeah, we already have a pull request for this.
Yeah.
Lemon Boy already made a pull request, and it's better than mine. So this problem is already fixed, but it's nice to use the debugger for. So this, just to make it clear, this type not equals nil is what's wrong. Because this type is here initialized with nil, and then it's set to tie anything. If there's a type expression in the AST, and we have a type expression, and now it's not nil anymore, and the condition is wrong, because we should treat it the same way. At least that's what I think.
Yeah, well, we should say an automatic type is as good as the nil type here, because it doesn't convey any information for us.
Yeah, that's why my patch was like, here is the type tie anything, and if it's tie anything, I just set it to nil and everything works as before. But Lemon Boy didn't agree on that patch. He...
Yes, well, he remarked that the logic should follow the same for constants, should follow the same logic for let and vars, and so his pull request reflects.
Yeah, he's right about it. The code should be consistent. Okay, now I want to show you when I did the call to debug type. So I quit for now, quit the debug. So debug type, export C debug type. This is how you can mark a function to have a specific name in the generated C and therefore also in the debugger. So when you want to call functions, it's nice if you don't need the extra, how is it called, the hashing?
The name mangling?
Yeah, the name mangling. I mean, it's not pure name mangling because name mangling implies that you can't reverse it and get the information back. It's just a hash from the names, I think.
I don't know if the definition of name mangling implies that it's reversible, but okay. One disadvantage here.
Yeah, you need to have separate names. The names are all in one global namespace. These procs and nim are all called debug, but you cannot give them all the same name in C because the name needs to be unique.
But that's not my point. My point is the problem with this is what you also tell the compiler is that it must not eliminate this debug type and debug node function, even if it's not used. Well, that's probably what you want for for GDB debugging, but it's not what I want if I compile a release version of the compiler because it increases the binary size. So what could be done here is to make this optional, this export C, only if we are in a debugger native mode, then we get this export
C. We can just make defined. When not defined release.
Yeah.
I mean, therefore debugging purpose.
You can also check if the debugger is native, is set to native. But to be honest, I forgot the syntax for that. It's when compile option. But never mind.
I mean, it's exactly what you want when you have these functions are not used internally, at least normally they are not used internally. They shouldn't be used internally, or they should only be used for debugging purpose. And when you have a function just for debugging purpose, that's only called from GDB, this is exactly what you want. You don't want the code optimizer to throw it away just because it isn't used.
That's true, but technically, I could also want to debug a release version of the compiler.
Well, for sure. Then, yeah, debugging a release version is always a bit tricky. It's possible, but it's never the best. I mean, it's called release for a reason, because it's harder to debug. There are always trade-offs. But we don't need to discuss that here on our...
In my experience, a release is not really harder to debug than anything else. Well, speaking in GDB terms, like, does backtracing still work? Yes. Does the inspection of local variables still work in release? Yes. So everything continues to work. Except that it's optimized the sampler code, and so...
Yeah,
the control flow might be confusing, but
I personally don't like the term release and debug build because it's two things that are very orthogonal. You have optimizations that can be turned on or turned off, and you have debug symbols. And saying I have a release mode with debug information is a bit It conflicts with my how I call things. I think it should be either optimized or not optimized, or debug symbols or not debug symbols. And the release is optimized at no debug symbols, and the debug is it has debug symbols, but
there's there's not a problem here. You can call, you can compile with a release switch and with debugger native at the same time, and it just works.
Yeah, I know. I just don't like the names, but anyway, I think our debugging session came to an end here. We said what we want to say. That's it. Goodbye.
Bye-bye.